This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book The Insurrection in Dublin by James Stevens. Chapter 1, Monday. This has taken everyone by surprise. It is possible that with the exception of their staff, it has taken the volunteers themselves by surprise. But today, our peaceful city is no longer peaceful. Guns are sounding or rolling and crackling from different directions, and, although rarely, the rattle of machine guns can be heard also. 2 days ago, war seemed very far away, so far that I have covenanted with myself to learn the alphabet of music. Tom Bodkin had promised to present me with a musical instrument called a dulcimer. I persist in thinking that this is a species of guitar, although I am assured that it is a number of small metal plates which are struck with sticks, and I confess that this description of its function prejudices me more than a little against it. There is no reason why I should think dubiously of such an instrument, but I do not relish the idea of procuring music with a stick. With this dulcimer, I shall be able to tap out our Irish melodies when I am abroad, and transport myself to Ireland for a few minutes or a few bars. In preparation for this present, I had through Saturday and Sunday been learning the notes of the scale. The notes and spaces on the lines did not trouble me much, but those above and below the line seemed ingenious and complicated to a degree that frightened me. On Saturday, I got the Irish Times and found in it a long article by Bernard Shaw, reprinted from the New York Times. One reads things written by Shaw. Why one does read them, I do not know exactly, except that it is a habit we got into years ago, and we read an article by Shaw just as we put on our boots in the morning, that is, without thinking about it, and without any idea of reward. His article angered me exceedingly. It was called Irish Nonsense Talked in Ireland. It was written, as is almost all of his journalistic work, with that bonhomie which he has cultivated. It is his mannerism, and which is essentially hypocritical and untrue. Bonhomie. It is that man of the world attitude, that shop attitude, that between you and me for are we not equal and cultured attitude, which is the tone of a card sharper or a trick of the loop man. That was the tone of Shaw's article. I wrote an open letter to him, which I sent to the New Age, because I doubted that the Dublin papers would print it if I sent it to them, and I knew that the Irish people who read the other papers had never heard of Shaw, except as a trademark, under which very good Limerick bacon is sold, and that they would not be interested in the opinions of a person named Shaw on any subject not relevant to bacon. I struck out of my letter a good many harsh things which I said of him, and hoped he would reply to it, in order that I could furnish these acidities to him in a second letter. That was Saturday. On Sunday I had to go to my office, as the director was absent in London, and there I applied myself to the notes and spaces below the stave, but relinquished the exercise, convinced that these mysteries were unattainable by man, while the knowledge that above the stave there were others and not less complex stayed mournfully with me. I returned home, and as novels, perhaps it is only for the duration of the war, do not now interest me, I read for some time in Madame Blavatsky's Secret Doctrine, which book interests me profoundly. George Russell was out of town, or I would have gone round to his house in the evening to tell him what I thought about Shaw, and to listen to his own much finer ideas on that, as on every other subject. I went to bed. On the morning following, I awoke into full insurrection and bloody war, but I did not know anything about it. It was bank holiday, but for employments such as mine there are not any holidays, so I went to my office at the usual hour, and after transacting what business was necessary, I bent myself to the notes above and below the stave, and marveled anew at the ingenuity of man. Peace was in the building, and if any of the attendants had knowledge or rumor of war, they did not mention it to me. At 1 o'clock I went to lunch. Passing the corner of Marion Row, I saw two small groups of people. These people were regarding steadfastly in the direction of St. Stephen's Green Park, and they spoke occasionally to one another with that detached confidence which proved they were mutually unknown. I also, but without approaching them, stared in the direction of the green. I saw nothing but the narrow street which widened to the park. Some few people were standing in tentative attitudes, and all looking in the one direction. As I turned from them homewards, I received an impression of silence and expectation and excitement. On the way home, I noticed that many silent people were standing in their doorways, an unusual thing in Dublin, outside of the back streets. The glance of a Dublin man or woman conveys generally a criticism of one's personal appearance and is a little hostile to the passer. The look of each person as I passed was steadfast and contained an inquiry instead of a criticism. I felt faintly uneasy, but withdrew my mind to a meditation which I had covenanted with myself to perform daily, and passed to my house. There I was told that there had been a great deal of rifle firing all the morning, and we concluded that the military recruits or volunteer detachments were practicing that arm. My return to business was by the way I had already come. At the corner of Marion Row, I found the same silent groups who were still looking in the direction of the green and addressing each other occasionally with the detached confidence of strangers. Suddenly, and on the spur of the moment, I addressed one of these silent gazers. "Has there been an accident?" said I. I indicated the people standing about. "What's all this for?" He was a sleepy, rough-looking man about 40 years of age, with a blunt red mustache and the distant eyes which one sees in sailors. He looked at me, stared at me, as at a person from a different country. He grew wakeful and vivid. "Don't you know?" said he. And then he saw that I did not know. "The Sinn Feiners have seized the city this morning." "Oh," said I. He continued, with the savage earnestness of one who has amazement in his mouth. "They seized the city at 11 o'clock this morning. The green there is full of them. They have captured the castle. They have taken the post office." "My God," said I, staring at him, and instantly I turned and went running towards the green. In a few seconds I banished astonishment and began to walk. As I drew near, the green rifle fire began like sharply cracking whips. It was from the further side. I saw that the gates were closed, and men were standing inside with guns on their shoulders. I passed a house, the windows of which were smashed in. As I went by, a man in civilian clothes slipped through the park gates, which instantly closed behind him. He ran towards me, and I halted. He was carrying two small packets in his hand. He passed me hurriedly, and, placing his leg inside the broken window of the house behind me, he disappeared. Almost immediately, another man in civilian clothes appeared from the broken window of another house. He also had something, I don't know what, in his hand. He ran urgently towards the gates, which opened, admitted him, and closed again. In the center of this side of the park, a rough barricade of carts and motor cars had been sketched. It was still full of gaps. Behind it was a halted tram, and along the vistas of the green one saw other trams derelict, untenanted. I came to the barricade. As I reached it and stood by the Shelburne Hotel, which it faced, a loud cry came from the park. The gates opened, and three men ran out. Two of them held rifles with fixed bayonets. The third gripped a heavy revolver in his fist. They ran towards a motor car which had just turned the corner and halted it. The men with bayonets took position instantly on either side of the car. The man with the revolver saluted, and I heard him begging the occupants to pardon him and directing them to dismount. A man and woman got down. They were again saluted and requested to go to the sidewalk. They did so. Note, as I pen these words, rifle shot is cracking from three different directions and continually. 3 minutes ago, there was 2 discharges from heavy guns. These are the first heavy guns used in the insurrection, the 25th of April. The man crossed and stood by me. He was very tall and thin, middle-aged, with a shaven, wasted face. "I want to get down to Armagh today," he said to no one in particular. The loose bluish skin under his eyes was twitching. The volunteers directed the chauffeur to drive to the barricade and lodge his car in a particular position there. He did it awkwardly, and after three attempts he succeeded in pleasing them. He was a big brown-faced man, whose knees were rather high for the seat he was in, and they jerked with the speed and persistence of something moved with a powerful spring. His face was composed and fully under command, although his legs were not. He locked the car into the barricade, and then, being a man accustomed to be commanded, he awaited an order to descend. When the order came, he walked directly to his master, still preserving all the solemnity of his features. These two men did not address a word to each other, but their drilled and expressionless eyes were loud with surprise and fear and rage. They went into the hotel. I spoke to the man with the revolver. He was no more than a boy, not more certainly than 20 years of age, short in stature, with close curling red hair and blue eyes, a kindly-looking lad. The strap of his sombrero had torn loose on one side, and except while he held it in his teeth, it flapped about his chin. His face was sunburnt and grimy with dust and sweat. This young man did not appear to me to be acting from his reason. He was doing his work from a determination implanted previously, days, weeks perhaps, on his imagination. His mind was where? It was not with his body. And continually his eyes went searching widely, looking for spaces, scanning hastily the clouds, the vistas of the streets, looking for something that did not hinder him, looking away for a moment from the immediacies and rigors which were impressed where his mind had been. When I spoke, he looked at me, and I know that for some seconds he did not see me. I said, "What is the meaning of all this? What has happened?" He replied collectedly enough in speech, but with that ramble and errancy clouding his eyes. "We have taken the city. We are expecting an attack from the military at any moment, and those people," he indicated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.